ODBC connector stage. So this can be used for multiple databases, any database that supports the ODBC driver. Once we have created the data source at the back end, we simply need to give those credentials over here to be able to connect to that database. So in this example, we have hard-coded the values, but ideally we should be creating parameters. Preferably, we should be creating environment variables, because these will be common across all the jobs that the data stage project will be having. If it's pointing to the same subject area, probably the database will be more or less the same. Once we have given those credentials that are required to connect to the database, we have simple options. This is the example of ODBC connector stage as a source. So we are trying to read from a database table. We can enable the job to read from a table directly. So data stage itself at the back end will generate a SQL, a select SQL statement. That is true in case we are reading from a single table. So if we are reading from a single table, we have the option to let data stage generate the select SQL itself. So in that case, we need to set the generate SQL property to yes. We just need to specify the table name, giving the schema and the table name, preferably again as parameters. They can also be hard-coded. But in a practical environment, in a project environment, we'll be passing parameters. And there's another option. If we do not want to generate the SQL, then the option is set this to no, set the generate SQL property to no, and write in your or type in your own select statement. So we can, when we type in our own select statement, we can select from one table, we can select from multiple tables, we can perform a join at the database level itself between different tables, we can specify where clauses, we can order by if we want to. So we can do all those, SQL properties can be given in the select statement if we decide not to generate it through data stage itself. Now there's some other properties. There's a property called enable quoted identifiers. This is again database specific. So this is basically to handle the case sensitivity within the database. So if a table is created in any database using quotes, then it is case sensitive. So here we have to set this to yes. So automatically whatever statement we are typing in, it will enclose the table name and the schema name and the column names within quotes. And then they'll be treated as case sensitive. So only if a case sensitive match is found in the database, then this will result in an output. Otherwise, by default, whatever we write, so this we have written in caps itself, but even if we write in lowercase, then by default, data stage converts it into uppercase and then tries to execute that statement at the database level. So if the database is case sensitive, then in that case, we need to enable the quoted identifiers so that all the schema names, column names, table names will be enclosed within quotes and they'll be treated as case sensitive. The select statement can also be written in a file and provided. So we need to provide the path name and the file name if we want to parameterize it. So this statement that we have typed here can also be parameterized. We can define a parameter and type in a statement as pass it as a value to that parameter. But there will be some constraints, the length constraints, and some special characters might not be allowed. So in that case, we can write the select statement in a file and read the file and use it as a parameter. The other property is enable partition reads. So this is to impose partitioning on the database stage. So depending on which connector we are using, there would be some kinds of partitioning which will be defined. So if we set this to yes, there are two kinds for the ODBC connector stage, the minimum and maximum range and the modulus. So minimum and maximum range, basically we need to define the table name and the column name. So based on the column name values, it will generate some minimum and maximum range for each node and partition the data according to that generated range. That is in minimum and maximum range. If we define the partitioning as modulus, then it does the modulus of that column name by the number of nodes and then assigns it to that partition number. So it does a modulus by the column value, by the number of nodes, and assigns it to that partition number. So this can impose some kind of partitioning in the database stage. If you want to have partition reads, so obviously if we go for partition reads, then the database read statement would be faster, so the processing will be faster for the select statement. So the partitioning technique can be selected at this point. Then the other important properties, and these are very important properties, setting the record count and the array size. So by default, they're always set to 2000. In most of the cases, that is sufficient. But if the table is really huge, there's a lot of data, there's a lot of volume of data in the table, then we can think of increasing these numbers as well. We should not try to decrease them, because what these mean is record count is basically the number of records that will be handled in one transaction from data set to the database. So these are the number of records that will be passed to the database in one transaction of data stage. Array size basically defines the number of records after which a commit is done. So the larger the number of records, fewer will be the commits and the processing might be faster. If you decrease this value, then more commits will happen. Again, if we increase it to a very large value, then the commit will happen after, let's say we increase it to 10,000 records and a database commit happens after the 10,000 records. In that case also, there's an issue that the table might be logged and the other applications might not be able to access that table. So even that is not advised, because for that much duration, the table will be logged because the commit has not been performed. So again, we need to set it to an optimum value. In most of the cases, this limit will work of 2000. There's also a database level property, which is the isolation level. So isolation level is basically, it has options like read uncommitted or read committed. It basically tells the degree of isolation. So when data stage is performing one operation on the data, some other operation, some other application is trying to perform some other operation, then will that application be allowed to read only the committed records or the uncommitted records, or will it be able to modify the data that is being held by the data stage transaction? So that depends on the isolation level property, what is being set here. Again, by default, it's read uncommitted, so we can leave it to that. So it's only when there are advanced issues and there's a lot of performance issues, then we should change these options. Otherwise, we can leave them to their default values, which are optimal values for that connector stage to work. So this is the example of modulus. And then we have all these options of schema reconciliation, which is basically the size mismatch. So there's a columns tab here wherein we need to go and define the column. So now I've selected two columns only from my table because I needed just two columns from the tables. So ideally I should be importing the table definition so that I make sure that I have the same data types defined on my columns tab as well. But in some cases, probably I define a column and there's a mismatch in that data type with the database column. So in that case, we can define if we want the job to fail, if there's a size mismatch, if we want the job to fail in case there's a type data type mismatch. So by default, these are set to yes. So the job will fail if there's a data type or data size mismatch. The other important properties, and these are also very important and many times used, are the before and after SQL statements. So if there's any operation we want to perform before the actual select statement that we have specified is executed, then we need to specify a before statement for creating index, probably for rebuilding index. So in all those cases, before and after statements will be used. The after SQL will be executed once the select statement, the main statement that the ODBC connector is executing, has executed. After that, once that statement, the after SQL will be fired. So these statements will be fired once before the execution of the stage happened and once after the execution of the stage has finished. There is also an option at the bottom to limit the number of return rows. So for debugging purposes, we can set it to yes. By default, it is no because we do not want to restrict. We want to read all the input records which are coming from the database table. But there is an option to set it to no. By default, it is no. We can set it to yes for debugging purposes. And we can specify some value. By default, it's 1,000 records. We can specify some value which is larger than 1,000 records. So this will only be for debugging purposes, because we would not be wanting to restrict the number of records that we are reading from the table. Any kind of restriction, if we want to apply, then we should apply in the SQL that we are writing by providing a proper where clause. So all those should be done through the SQL. As much of the processing as can be logically done at the database level should be done, because a database processing happens within the database. There is no input-output transactions happening between data stage and database. So it is always faster at the database level compared to doing that same operation through data stage. Then using the same ODBC connector stage as a target, most of the options will be similar. The differences would be in the write mode. So there are many options for the write modes: insert new rows only, update, delete, insert then update then insert, and delete then insert. So the commonly used options would be insert, update, delete, insert then update then insert. Whatever option we select, if we say insert, and by default the generate SQL is set to no. So by default we just need to, if it is set to no, then we need to provide an insert statement. If we put the generate SQL to yes and we specify the write mode as insert, then again, we just need to give the table name, specifying the proper schema and the proper table. These are the common properties as well available for the source stage as well, quoted identifiers, record count, and all those properties. So if we say generate SQL as yes, that means we are asking data stage to generate the SQL for the write mode that we have specified. So we said yes, we said insert. So we just need to provide the table, say a table name, and data stage will generate its own insert statement. Now, if we set the generate SQL to no, that means now we are supposed to provide the insert statement. So insert statement, again, whenever we provide any statement, insert, update, in which we are referring to the columns, we are setting the values based on the columns that we have processed through data stage. We have to refer to those columns which are coming from the data stage input link as orchestrate dot that column name, the data stage column name on the input link. So insert into, this is the table name. These are the table column names as specified in the database values, and these are the values that are coming to the input link of this ODBC connector. The values which are coming after processing is done on them through data stage. So all those input link columns have to be referred as orchestrate dot. So this is very important, and the ordering is very important, especially when we are doing updates and all. We should remember that any data stage column needs to be referred to as orchestrate dot and the column name that we have specified on the input link or the output link of the previous stage. So we say generate SQL no. Then the insert statement, this will be enabled. We can type in our own insert statement. If we say insert then update, then it will enable both the statements. So the insert statement, we can specify our own insert statement. We can specify our own update statement as well. And insert then update, so it will happen in that sequence. First the insert will happen and then the update will happen. Now, if we specify the write mode as insert, then in that case, we need to specify a table action as well. So we say the write mode is insert. That means I want to insert some records. We have to specify the table action as whether we want to append records to the existing data in the table, whether we want to create a new table and then insert the records. So if there's some temporary table that we want to create through data stage itself, then we have to select the table action as create. So So it will create based on the column definitions that we have defined on the columns tab. Whatever data type, whatever column names we have defined, whatever is the table name that we have provided in this statement or by or here, and whatever the data types that we have specified for the column, it will create that table and then insert the data into that table. The other option is replace. Replace is basically drop the table and then recreate it based on the column definition provided on the columns tab. The other option is truncate. So if those are staging tables, then mostly we'll be using the option as truncate. So truncate and load the staging table. So whatever data is already present in that table will be truncated and the new data will be inserted through this stage. Again, in the when we use ODBC connector stage as a target stage, we again have all those options of giving the before and after SQL statements. We also have some more options for logging the column values on first row error. So if there is an error inserting the record in the database table, then an entry would be made to the database, to the data stage job log. There would be a warning message in the job log that there was an error. So we can specify this property as well to log the rejected record into the data stage job log. And we can specify the before and after. So as we discussed earlier, when we are writing, the before and after would mostly be when we are loading big tables for rebuilding the indexes. So drop indexes will be the before statement and rebuild the statement could be the after SQL statement. So this is for the ODBC connectors. This will be mostly used when no other specific database connector stage is available for any of the databases that we are working with. In that case, we would go and use the ODBC connector provided that database supports the ODBC driver.